God's word is alive and it's active and it's sharper than any two-edged sword. And every time that we open God's word, that we are being examined by what is written. And as we read it a little further in Hebrews chapter 4, 12, that the word of God is a critic. It's a discerner of the thoughts, of the intentions of the heart. You know, I often say that God does surgery when anyone takes the time to open his word. So today, I want you guys to think of it in that way. You know, God is going to do spiritual surgery as we open our Bibles to the first chapter of James. As we have already seen, James asks us some really pointed questions. They are penetrating. And one of those questions we are actually going to entertain today is to whether or not we are doers of God's word. So he doesn't ask us to be hearers only, but he drives home the point of being doers as well. Now, before we move on and read the text in James' letter, I want to read a passage from Paul, who wrote to Timothy, and it's recorded in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 13 through 17. Paul writes also about being doers of God and how that should change our lives. So in 2 Timothy, starting with chapter 3, starting with verse 13, "But evil men and imposters will proceed from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. You, however, continue in the things that you have learned and become convinced of, knowing from whom you have learned them. And from childhood you have known the sacred writings, which are able to give you the wisdom that leads to salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. All scripture is inspired by God and is profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be adequate, equipped for every good work." Those are great, insightful words. Now let's look on how James kind of dovetails on those words. So listen closely as we read James 1, starting verse 19. "This you know, my beloved brethren, but everyone must be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger, for the anger of man does not achieve the righteousness of God. Therefore, putting aside all filthiness and all that remains of wickedness, in humility receive the word implanted, which is able to save our souls. But prove yourselves doers of the word, not merely hearers who delude themselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is a man who looks at his natural face in a mirror. For once he has looked at himself and gone away, he has immediately forgotten what kind of person he is. But one who looks intently at the perfect law, the law of liberty, and abides in it, not having become a forgetful hearer, but an effectual doer, this man will be blessed in what he does. If anyone thinks himself to be religious and yet does not bridle his tongue, but deceives his own heart, this man's religion is worthless. Pure and undefiled religion in the sight of our God and Father is this: to visit orphans and widows in their distress and keep oneself unstained by the word. Heavenly Father, we just dedicate this time right now, right here, to you. Holy Spirit, we ask that you would come and teach us. Lord, that you would give us ears to listen. Lord, not to just hear, Lord, but to really listen to what your Spirit has to say to your church. In Jesus' name, amen. So, I want to speak this morning about separation. Not the kind of separation that occurs between a husband and wife when they're not able to get along, but separation that takes place in a Christian between what he hears and what he does. So, understand that for many, there is a separation between hearing and understanding what to do and becoming the feet and hands and just doing it. And so I often wonder if the reason that we have so much difficulty with hearing from God and getting his words transformed, you know, into our lives is because we just can't handle change. As a matter of fact, I have often wondered if the doors that you guys go through back there when you leave this place have some kind of magic eraser that goes into operation when you just leave. You know, if that's the case, I pray that it only is operational on Sunday because this is a school. On the inside of these walls, and in our children's ministry classrooms, we are exposed to such depth of God's truth as we open our hearts to the scripture. But consider how little of it like gets seated in the car when we drive out the parking lot. How little of it actually makes it with us to our house. And then on Monday morning, how little of it is left to make it to us when we're at work. You see, that's why James makes such a point concerning this separation. You know, A.W. Tozer has become, without question, like one of my favorite writers, I suppose. It's because he challenges me, you know, to think like he does. Tozer writes, there is an evil which in its effect upon Christian religion may become more destructive than communism, Romanism, and liberalism combined. It is the glaring disparity between theology and practice among professing Christians. So why does this gulf that separates theory from practice in church so that an inquiring stranger that chances upon both would scarcely believe that there is any relationship between the two of them? And an intelligent observer of our human scene who heard the Sunday morning message and later watched the Sunday afternoon conduct of those who heard it would observe that he had been examining two distinct and contrary religions. Then he concludes, it appears to me that too many Christians want to enjoy the feel of feeling right, but are not willing to endure the inconvenience of being right. And so the separation between theory and what becomes practice becomes permanent. So listen to the last sentence that he had. Truth sits forsaken and grieves still her professed followers come home for a brief visit. But she sees them depart again when the bills come due. That is the question that I'm addressing myself in James chapter 1, 19 through 27, which I am calling the Great Separation. I would like for you to make for yourself and perhaps to the Lord a personal promise at the beginning of this message. I'd like for you to promise to the Lord that you will only think about one person today. Not the person sitting across the room. Not the person that you hope to send this message to. Not the person sitting next to you. But the person that occupies the chair that you're sitting in. I hope you will promise God today for this time that we spend together right now that you will only think of you and this passage and in this scripture. Now, in order to make that promise, I'm going to ask that you bow your heads with me right now. Lord, we pray that we will make this passage of Scripture meaningful to me, to teach to each person, Lord, who hears this message, not that we might share it, but that we would apply it. In Jesus' name, amen. So James chapter 1, 19 through 27 begins with what I would call general observations. You know, I find four of them as a prerequisite for this message. First, I find that this is imperative truth. Verse 19, it begins to read as if it's an indicative statement, but it says, "This you know, my beloved brethren." So it's like you already know this. However, I believe that it ought to be taken as an imperative, like a command. It says, "Know this." This is he's saying, "Listen up." You know, he's saying, this is imperative. This is significant. So we begin by saying, this is imperative truth. The second observation I have to make is that this is family truth. He says, my beloved brethren. This is the New Testament way of saying, my Christian friend. Christian, this is for those of us in the family. James is writing to believers, so it assumes that you know the Lord and that it's talking to you and as a member of God's family. So this is family truth. You know, he says, my beloved brethren. Third, this is personal truth. He says, but everyone. So it's like if he's covering all of us here with an immense blanket, you know, saying, let everyone in the family listen up. God is speaking. So this is imperative truth. This is family truth. And this is personal truth. And not for the fellow sitting on the other side of the church, but right now for you. And fourth, this is logical truth. I say that because the passage unfolds as logical as like anything unfolds in the New Testament, maybe with the exception of Romans. It begins with the time of preparation for the truth. By truth, of course, I mean the Scriptures. It begins with how the heart must be made ready for the sowing of the seed. And then in logical progression, it goes to the time when the word is actually implanted in verse 21. James prepares for us the sowing and then it is implanted. And then he talks about how it is best done. And third, there is this period of response, the time for us to receive, you know. It's in verses 22 through 27. So that's the progression of this passage. And now you have promised God, I hope, that you will take it personally. So let's go back to verse 19. Now that, and look at the first requisite for receiving the truth. In receiving the truth, we must be prepared. So how are we to be prepared? Verse 19 says, let everyone be quick to hear. So James here is concerned with what we are to be, not with what we are to do. God is like that. He's far more interested in what we are to be than he is in what we are to do. First, we must have an open ear. We must be quick to hear, to really hear what God wants to lodge in your heart. You must hear what God has said. Jesus constantly rebuked the Pharisees by saying, have you not heard? They had heard all through their training and through their hypocritical teaching, but they had not listened. It's possible to be good of hearing and hard of listening. It's possible to hear words and not what it really means to your heart. It happens every day in this place on Sunday, and it happens like in every church all around the world. Satan has a way of dulling the hearing. And not just Satan, but we ourselves. So James says, be prepared yourself, for the truth. You must have an open ear. You must be ready to listen. Now, the second in verse 19, it continues, let everyone be slow to speak. A controlled tongue is second. God has given us two ears, one mouth, two avenues for listening, and one for sharing. Doesn't it make sense that we would spend more time on the two than the one? How often have we commented that we never learn when we are speaking? We learn while we are listening. How much time is spent in silence, preparing yourself for the sowing to the word? We do not hear from God while we speak. We must learn to listen. It's funny, I heard a story from about a professor a number of years ago. He was being honored in a faculty procession at a reception. There was a long line, so he was standing in this procession. And his area that he taught was communications. And so he decided he was going to run this experiment. And so he decided that he would say the same sentence to every individual that goes by and speaks to him. The sentence that he chose to say is, my grandmother died last night. Now, it wasn't true. It was just a statement to see what the response would be. He says, and I quote, don't worry about what people think. The large majority don't. It's rare to find anyone who really listens to what we're saying. As I said to each one that my grandmother died last night, I had replies such as, well, congratulations, Dr. Madsen. Nice to see that you're here this evening, and how wonderful it is to have you with us. Now, you guys probably spoke to a number of people already this morning. Do you remember what they said in return? Many of you asked, how are you today? A few of those might have even been honest enough to tell you how they really are. Did you listen? Really, really listen? More important than that, God doesn't speak through earthquakes. God speaks with a still, small voice. And it's still true. The listening ear must be keenly tuned to him. Now, there must be, thirdly, a calm spirit. He says, let everyone be slow to anger. Well, we ask why. Why, James? Because the anger of man does not achieve the righteousness of God. You see, the picture that we get in verse 19 and 20 is a picture of agitation. For the spirit to be calm, there cannot be the presence of anger. You don't hear while you are angry. You just don't hear well. You know, that's why arguments really, really don't get anywhere. Usually one or both are angry during the time of communication. And God says, he says, don't be angry. Don't get agitated. In what condition did you come into this service? Did you come to worship prepared? Do you take the time to just be quiet and prepare your hearts to receive, you know, what the Lord has to tell you before you come? You know, I know there's lots of people, you know, it's just all hustle and bustle, you know, you're arguing at home before you get here, sometimes yelling at the kids. Is your heart prepared to listen and receive? Coming to an understanding of this, like, has been huge for me this week. You know, as I am mulling over all these thoughts that I get by reading this passage and trying to decide on what to teach, I've decided that I need to keep my Saturday nights completely open, and I need to, like, schedule nothing so that I can just be quiet and still before the Lord, so that I'm fully prepared for, you know, and be in the right place when I come to share with you. And I get to thinking, so, like, that's true for you also. You know, how sweet would it be if I'm prepared to share and you're just as prepared to listen? Have you ever had to paint a house? You know, what do? When you're going to paint the house, you have to get out a pressure washer and wash off the dirt, right? A scraper, usually something to, all, wherever it's chip paint, you have to scrape it. You have to prepare it, right? Before you paint it, right? And I think of the time, like, it takes to prepare, like, a large holiday meal. You know, the cooking starts, the preparation for it starts at least the day before. And then you're cooking all day that day also, all to be consumed in like 40 minutes. You know, doesn't it seem logical that when God has a meal for us, that we should take some time preparing for the meal? That's what he's saying here. That's why he's saying, know this. If you'll do it for the painting of the house, if you're going to do it for the preparation of a meal, why won't you do it for your soul? So, we need an open ear, a controlled tongue, a calm spirit, and there's still one other. We need a clean heart. Look at verse 21. Therefore, putting aside all filthiness and all that remains of wickedness, there are two areas that James mentions as a clean heart here. First, there's the removal of all filthiness, and second, of all everything else that remains. They are very vivid terms. The word filthiness in the Greek was often used by a physician that described wax in the ear that plugged up the sound Isn't that interesting? Filthiness is in our life plugs the hearing. The soul that comes ill-prepared because of dirt in his life and heart doesn't get the same message that a clean heart gets. That's how God designed it. You have to take time to unload that burden of guilt of sin and the things that have crept in, and there's just that removal of all that remains of wickedness. And so it's a beautiful picture of the network of wrong beneath the surface. The filthiness will be the things that are obvious. And then there must be the uprooting of the little things, the motives, the attitudes, the non-surface things that corrupt you so that you cannot hear what God is saying. That's what he's mentioning here. So you know that there is nothing like preparation, nothing like it. You know, there's no doctor that when you come into his office and he discovers, whoa, you have a bad heart. Here, lay down on the table and I'll take care of it right now. You wouldn't do that. He says, let's get you scheduled quickly and get you into the hospital. You know, let's put you on a strict diet, you know, and like give you some strict medication. And, you know, all this carefully prepared, you know, by the physician and his staff. And you know, you when the time comes to actually have surgery, you get the right anesthesia, you know. And, you know, there's a germ-free environment there in the operating room. And with all the skilled assistants, you know, they go to work on the heart. You don't go into it with dirty hands. That's what James is saying here. You've got to prepare. You know, I think I can even make it more clear for you. Let's say that you want to take an airplane trip to go see the Valenzuelas in Spain. Yeah? So, like, you've flown a number of times, and so like you have your favorite airlines and all, but you also like to get it cheap, you know, as least expensive as you can. And so you see this ad on this airlines, and you read this ad, and it's called the Old World Airline. And now they've only been in business for 8 days, but you want to check it out anyhow. So you call. And the young lady answers the phone, and she goes, she's all in a hurry. She really doesn't have time to talk with you because she's the stewardess on the plane that's about ready to take off. And so she says, look, why don't you just come down and see for yourself? We're half price from anybody. And so you decide to do that. You go over there, and you look out, and there's this 1947 B-17. And there's a 19-year-old pilot. He's getting ready, and he's all in a hurry. And you ask him, say, hey, well, what are you doing? And he says, well, we're in a hurry. We're actually late taking off. And you ask him, well, why are you half price? For what reason can you cut the fare that much? And he says, well, we don't worry about unnecessary things like maintenance. And we kind of cut the cost on fuel a lot. And we serve leftovers for meals. And so you notice that the pilot is also wearing a parachute. Now, there's not a person in his right mind that's going to get on that airplane, at least without a parachute himself. So why... You know, there is no preparation, you know. It would be stupid to do that. You know, we've plunged into this service, into his word, like we're on a time schedule. You know, speak now, Lord, or you're going to lose a chance. You know, I'm ready right now. You know, there's a football game in an hour. You know, God doesn't fit into our framework like that. God says, you'll do it my way or you'll live in separation. It'll never take place in your life. So that's why there is an open ear, a controlled tongue, a calm spirit, and a clean heart. Now, we've got that and we're ready. Let's look specifically at the truth itself. I love verse 21. Putting aside all filthiness and all the network of wickedness down beneath the surface, and that takes time, then he deals with an attitude, humility, and an action. He says, receive. In humility, receive the word implanted, which is able to save your souls. Look how carefully at that verse, the word humility. It's a gracious word. It means gentleness. It's the idea of a teachable spirit. Lord, I'm teachable. Regardless of who has cooked the meal, I am ready to learn. A gentle openness. And then he said, receive the word. It's a word of great hospitality. In the first century, it was a word that means welcome to my home. That's what God is saying. The person that really gets the word implanted into his soul is the one who isn't a finicky eater. He's not particular about who prepared the meal. We had a word for finicky eaters around my house when I was growing up. Hungry. They didn't eat. If you didn't like what you were served, you just passed it on until the next meal. You know, a lot of Christians aren't like that. They want it with a particular finesse, a particular cook, served with the same utensils, very similar to what you've been accustomed to. I hope that's not anyone here. You know, since like we've had a change of chefs for a while, Chef Russ doesn't prepare the meal in the same manner that you've been accustomed to feasting on. And next week, we have a guest chef, and he will prepare it different again. But I promise you it will be delicious. And it's going to give me a chance to prepare for the next few delicious meals. And so, don't be a finicky eater. Ladies, have you ever served a finicky eater? It's like, don't you just want to smash the plate in their face? God says with humility, take what you're served. You know, that's what God says. One of the things that I've appreciated about this church is whether it's Pastor Josh, myself, or a guest speaker, you always come to the dinner table. That's the way it ought to be. In humility, regardless of the cook, take the word when it is served you. Take the word when it is implanted. It's able to deliver you. God is in the daily deliverance business. It wasn't just once and for all back when you got saved. Then there is the third process, and it's probably the most important of the three. There is the response. It doesn't end once the word is implanted. Verse 22 through 27 talk about the proper response that you, when you've eaten the meal. Verse 22 contains a command. 23 through 25 contains an illustration. And 26 through 27 an application. And so with that being laid out, let's dig into it. Verse 22, but prove yourselves doers of the word, not merely hearers who delude themselves. That's the command. Prove yourselves not doers only, not hearers only, but one who hears and then does. It's interesting that the word merely must be in part of this sentence. God isn't looking for the activists that operate without information. Many a church is filled with activists that don't know what God has said, you know. But either extreme is a church that is filled with people that take in what God has said and does nothing about it. Neither one is acceptable. God says, in order for there to be balance, then there is to be hearers and then doers. You know, that word hearer meant in the first century, it meant an auditor. An academic auditor, one who academically audited a course in a university. And I remember when I was going to Bible college that there were those who were, you know, there for a grade and working towards a goal. And then that there were those who were there to audit the course. You know, they were the most relaxed ones. They really were. All they did is come to listen and take notes. The rest of us had about 4 hours of homework after every single class and had tests to take. And it's like we were stressed, and like I was anyhow. But I learned so much more because I put the work into it. And so this church has some auditors taking the course. Sunday after Sunday, you take your notes, and I'm sure many of our very impressive notes, but you would be hard-pressed to show God or even the closest friend of yours that there has been a significant change since you started. Matter of fact, you could even think back when we were just in 1 Peter and any of those messages, or just a little bit further back when Josh taught on Titus. Or how about even just last week when I spoke about victory over temptation? Was there any difference? Have you made any significant change in your life because of any of those messages? Any changes that can pinpoint that God, you can say, God, see, that's proof. I am not auditing on Sunday morning. How about ministry in your home? How about the raising your children, the little ones around the house? You know, relational matters, whatever it is. Listen, this is dear to my heart. You know, not only is it something that I had to learn for myself after years of auditing church, I know that it's true amongst you because you end up in my office for counseling. And if you applied what you learned on Sunday morning, then I would have actually retired a couple years ago like I planned. James says, if you want to prove yourself, then prove yourself not as one who audits a course, but as a doer. Look at the illustration James gives us, verses 23 and 24. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man who looks at his natural face in a mirror. For once he has looked at himself and gone away, he has immediately forgotten what kind of person he was. Now he's not talking about a physical mirror here, because a physical mirror does not show what kind of person you are. It's God's spiritual mirror. It's his spiritual mirror that shows you what kind of person you are. And so this is a picture of a man who takes up the scriptures, looks into the scriptures, and is exposed to the same truth that everyone else is exposed to. And once he has gotten it, he closes it and goes his way and quickly forgets what God has said. Now, there is an effective doer that doesn't do that. Verse 25 describes him. But one who looks intently at the perfect law, the law of liberty, but it says he abides by it. He's different than the other guy. Not having become a forgetful hearer, but an effectual doer. This man will be blessed when he does. And the word means happy. It means he's going to be a happy Christian. Now, I can tell you that as I look over the congregation here, you all probably looked in the mirror before you came here this morning. Well, you should have looked in the mirror before you came this morning. And maybe, Paul, you probably looked in the mirror ahead of time, but after you got dressed, there's no way you would have put on something with a horse on the front of your shirt. I just know that. Y'all, you know, I can tell something else. Y'all did something about what you saw in the mirror. Matter of fact, Joe, it's a little too shiny this morning. Like, I get a glare, and so like next week, could you like turn it down? You wouldn't come like you were dressed when you like went to bed, right? You wouldn't come like when you got out of bed. You just wouldn't do that. I usually like let my sort of I don't shave on like Friday and Saturday, so I look pretty scruffy on Sunday morning. And so like I look in the mirror, I pay attention to it, and I take care of it. I'm sure that you guys appreciate that. There's a lot of work that has to be done to this face to make it presentable to you guys on a Sunday morning. What kind of person would look in the mirror and go, "Ah, man," and then walks away and heads to church? Well, we do that spiritually. You know, we open the Word and we go, "Hey, that was a great message. That was profound thinking." Like, you know, and then you just go off whistling Dixie, you know, on your way home. You know, what difference has it made? Well, none. You know, what does God say? He says, "I discount the act." You know, there's no reward, no change, no difference, no reward. And so you say that you love me, but you don't act like it, you don't show it, so you ask. You might ask, what are some specific examples of real Christianity? Like James says, "I am glad that you asked. I have three of them on the tip of my pen right here." Verse 26, "If there is no separation between the truth and the tongue, you have the genuine item. If anyone thinks himself to be religious and yet does not bridle his tongue but deceives his own heart, he is separate from me. This man's religion is worthless." Illustration number two, when there is no separation between the truth and the needs of others. Verse 27, "Pure and undefiled religion in the sight of our God and Father is this, to visit orphans and widows in their distress." Are you moved by the needs of others? That's not merely social, a social gospel. That's That's the gospel invading society. That's Christianity. It is Christianity that is moved by the needs of the community. It's saying, I don't mind being involved if it means helping. That's real Christianity. And third, if you keep yourself unstained by the word, there is no separation between truth and your uniqueness in society, you're on your way home. Wow. So James, like, doesn't he level us with some heavy, heavy blows? I want to tell you that applying the truth really works. And yeah, I know at times that you're all going to fail. Can I use myself just as an example? Because this just happened to me. Last week when I was preparing at the end of the week for the message I was going to bring to you last Sunday, it was late Friday, and I had flushed the toilet, and all of a sudden I noticed there's sewage coming up in my bathtub, and there's sewage coming up in the shower. And so we run water and everywhere, and it just gets worse. Obviously, I have a stoppage. So I call the home maintenance people that we contract with, and like I was hour and 5 minutes, I'm on the phone waiting to talk to a live person because I want it's an emergency. I need somebody out there now. And like all of a sudden, after waiting an hour and 5 minutes, the call drops. And so I call back again, and they tell me my wait time is another over hour. I just hung up. And so I kind of waited till the next day. And in the morning, on Saturday morning, I called again. I finally got to talk to somebody. And like they could not send somebody out until Tuesday. And so I'm going, oh man. And so I'm thinking, okay, there's gotta be somebody in the church that is a plumber, right? And so we do have one, and I called him, and you know, he has a family business, and he calls and has a truck sent out. And so they spend a lot of time trying to break through and get this thing cleaned. And they can't do it. And then he sends a camera in there, and he goes, you got a broken pipe, like, halfway underneath your foundation. And I'm going, oh, man, what is this going to cost me? And it's like, I'm all just, like, bumfuzzled about it, you know? And I'm also thinking, man, here I am. Can't use the toilets. We can't shower. And my wife is having surgery on Monday. Like, what am I going to do? And then I go, wait. Russ, don't you remember that old guy that just recently taught on trials and troubles? And how they are inevitable? And I was reminded that trials teach us patience and endurance. And suddenly, I began to apply everything that I had said. And you know what? It worked. I looked in the mirror and I began to change the very thing that was wrong. Would you bow your heads with me?